Okay, hello and welcome to Unacademy. I am Rajshekhar Reddy, faculty for Current Affairs. Before starting today's mock test, I would like to tell something about myself and about the Unacademy Learning App. So I am Rajshekhar Reddy. I have cleared the civil service examination in 2014 and I have been teaching, for the past 7 years. The subject that I deal is current affairs, and I am a BTech computer science graduate from JNTU, Hyderabad. So you need to download and subscribe to the Unacademy Learning App. So you get a number of advantages by downloading and subscribing to the Unacademy Learning App. So what advantages do you get by doing so? So you have daily live classes where you can chat with your educator, ask questions, engage in discussions, and also answer polls, all while the class is going on. Then the courses that are available on the learning app are structured and comprehensively deal with the syllabus. You also have live tests and quizzes on the Unacademy Learning App. So the top educators of our country conduct live tests and quizzes, and you have unlimited access to the content on the Unacademy Learning App. So you can watch these videos any number of times without any limit, and from the place and time of your choice. Okay, so India's best educators, as I've told you, are dealing on an Unacademy platform, so you have access to the best coaching facilities of the country on an Unacademy. Further, there are a number of different courses designed in each subject. For example, we have a current affairs course, so I have designed one course. So many educators are designing various courses on the Unacademy Learning App. You have to subscribe. So there are a number of subscription options available. So you can subscribe for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, and 24 months. The best option is the 24-month subscription, which gives you a 67% discount. You will get an additional 10% discount if you use my code RRUPSC. So if you use this code RRUPSC, you get a 10% additional discount. So the final transaction cost will be 57,600. And you can convert this transaction into no cost EMIs. So you need not pay any interest on this and convert the transaction into no cost EMIs. And this transaction can be extended for 24 months. So no cost EMI facility is available, which can be extended for 24 months. So this is the pitch which I have to make on the Unacademy Learning App. So this is a very good institution which offers coaching at a relatively cheap price compared to a number of other offline and online coaching institutions. And you also have access to the best coaching facilities of our country. Okay. So this is about the Learning App. Let us start the test series. So I have a number of courses that are designed. So I'll be giving you details of the courses which I have designed. So first course that is available, this is on the YouTube platform, Top 200 Topics in Current Affairs for Civil Services Prelims 2020. So these classes are available on YouTube. So we have already finished 13 lectures. We have already completed 80 topics in this. So we still have some 120 topics to be dealt in this series. The next series is top 50 topics in international relations for civil services prelims 2020. It will be also useful for the mains. So this will also be useful for the mains. So top 50 topics for civil services prelims 2020 in international relations. So this will also be useful for the mains. We have finished this series, and this series is available on the Unacademy Learning App. So this is available on the Unacademy Learners App. Similarly, there is one more series called Top 50 Topics in Polity for Civil Services Prelims 2020. So this is also available on the Unacademy learning app. So apart from these three, I have started a test series. This test series is in current affairs. So this is entitled mock test. So mock test in current affairs and mock test in polity. So you need to attempt as many questions as possible, and you need to attend as many mock tests as possible to clear the civil services prelims examination. So these questions are prepared keeping in mind the prelims examination of 2020. So this is very important for you. So let us start today's mock test. So what is the first question for today's mock test? So consider the following pairs. So I have given four key rates, four key policy rates, and I have added the numbers here. So what is the pair that is correctly matched? So consider the following pairs, policy rate and what is the prevailing rate. So repo 4.25%, reverse repo 3.35%, MSF rate 4.25%, and the bank rate 4.5%. So what is the answer here? Okay, so the answer for this question is B and C only. So the prevailing repo rate is 4%, it is not 4.25%, and the prevailing repo rate is 3.35%, and the marginal standing facility rate is 4.25%, and the bank rate is also 4.25%. You must know the definitions of these rates, so they are very, very important for the examination. So the repo rate is the rate at which the RBI lends to the commercial banks on a short-term basis. So on a short-term basis, the RBI lends to the commercial banks against securities, against government securities. And repo stands for repurchase options or a repurchase agreement. Reverse repo is the opposite of repo. So it is the rate at which the central bank, so that is the RBI, borrows from the commercial banks. And there is a repurchase agreement here also. So they will be purchasing the securities once again at a predetermined time. Marginal standing facility rate is the rate at which banks take or borrow from the central bank, that is the Reserve Bank of India, on an emergency basis. So if there is a serious shortfall in funds on an emergency basis or an overnight basis, they take money, and this is at present 4.25%. And you must also know something about the bank rate. So bank rate is the rate at which RBI extends loans. So RBI gives loans to the banks without any collateral, and you must know that this is also a very, very important topic. So bank rate at present is 4.25%. So you must know the prevailing rates. So these are the key rates used by the Monetary Policy Committee to control what is called inflation, and by controlling inflation, they control the money supply in the economy. So the money supply in the economy is controlled by the Reserve Bank of India using key policy rates. So the policy rates that are at present prevalent is repo rate, that is 4%, reverse repo rate is 3.35%, marginal standing facility rate is 4.25%, and the bank rate is also 4.25%. If the rate of inflation is high, the government or the Monetary Policy Committee increases the reverse repo rate as well as the repo rate. So they increase both the repo rate as well as the reverse repo rate. Okay, so this is something which you need to know. So definitions of key economic terms are very, very important for your exam. definitions of key economic terms are very important for your exam. So you have to study thoroughly the definitions. So you need to know what is the bank rate, marginal standing facility rate, repo rate, and the reverse repo rate. So the answer for this question, as I've told you, is B and C only. So let us move on to the next question. So what is the next question? So which of the following acts was invoked by various states to control the spread of COVID-19? So as you all know, on March 11th, if I'm not wrong, March 11, 2020, the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 as a pandemic. A pandemic is a new disease. In order to be qualified as a pandemic, it should be a new disease and it should spread rapidly over several countries. So if a new disease spreads rapidly over several countries, then it is classified as a pandemic. The last time the World Health Organization declared a disease as a pandemic was the swine flu pandemic in 2009. So after 11 years, they have declared one more pandemic. So Indian government found it difficult to control this pandemic. So we did not have any specific law to give powers to the central government or the state governments to deal with a pandemic situation. This is some sort of a health emergency. It is a health emergency, and there are no provisions in the Constitution of India to deal with what is called a health emergency. In such a situation, what has the government of India done? So which act was invoked by the government of India or the states to deal with COVID-19? So the answer for this question is Epidemic Diseases Act. So the answer for this question is Epidemic Diseases Act. The Epidemic Diseases Act was enacted in the year 1897, and it was enacted and applied to the state of Bombay. So it was applied to the province of Bombay in order to deal with bubonic plague. So bubonic plague was spreading rapidly, and in order to deal with this, this act was invoked. So this is still prevalent, and section 2 of the Epidemic Diseases Act of 1897 says that if the laws that are prevailing are not sufficient to deal with any health emergency, then the state can use various powers to control a particular disease. So this act gives power to the state governments to take various measures to control the spread of a disease. And that is what the state governments have done in the recent period. So they have invoked what is called the Epidemic Diseases Act to control the spread of COVID-19. So you have to remember this act, very, very important. So recently this act has been in the news. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. So what is the next question? So Operation Sanjeevani was launched by the government of India to help which of the following nations to deal with COVID-19? So India has extended help to some countries during the recent period to help them, so to enable them to handle what is called COVID-19. So which country was helped by India under a mission which has been named as Operation Sanjeevani? So the options are Sri Lanka, Maldives, Nepal, and Bangladesh. So what is the answer here? Okay, so the answer for this question is Maldives. So Maldives is the country which benefited from Operation Sanjeevani. So we have sent them emergency medical supplies, including masks, facial masks, as well as hydrochloroquine medicine to deal with COVID-19. So Maldives is a country which is very close to India, and we have extended a helping hand to Maldives in this context. Okay, what else? So what is the next question? So what is this answer? So the theme of the 2020 World Health Day is, so what is the theme of the World Health Day 2020? So first option is support nurses and midwives, universal health coverage, so everyone everywhere, diabetes, let's talk depression, let's talk. So what is the answer here? So can anybody answer this question? So I see Hussein, Siva, Nandu participating in the quiz here. So what is the answer? So the answer for this question is support nurses and midwives. So the World Health Organization at regular intervals, the World Health Organization commemorates what is called 7 days. So what are those days? So the first day is the World Health Day. So the World Health Day is observed on April 7th. Then we have the Malaria Day. Malaria Day is observed on April 25th. I think we have the Tuberculosis Day, which is observed on March 24. We have the No Tobacco Day. So No Tobacco Day is observed on May 31st. So we have the Blood Donor Day, which is observed on June 14th. Hepatitis Day. Hepatitis Day is observed on July 28th, and the AIDS Day. AIDS Day is observed on December 1st. So I have missed these days. So TB Day is observed on March 24. Health Day is observed on April 7, and Malaria Day is observed on April 25. So these are the 7 days that are observed by the World Health Organization. So this is something which is important for you. So the theme of the World Health Day 2020 is support nurses and midwives. So you just have to remember the themes. So for 2020, we have this theme. Interestingly, for both 2019 and 2018, they had this theme. So universal health coverage, everyone everywhere. For 2017, we had this theme of diabetes, and for 2016, they had the theme of depression, let's talk. Okay, so please remember international days. So a question can be asked on international days, important international days, and the themes of various international days. Okay, so if you have not read this topic till now, so please read this topic. This is a very important topic for your examination, not just the civil service examination, but for all other competitive examinations. So let us move on to the next question. Let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. Consider the following nations: Yemen, Lebanon, Libya, and Chile. In which of the above nations is a civil war prevalent? So in which countries do we have a civil war? So I'll give you 30 seconds to answer. Okay, so nobody has answered this. So there is a civil war which is prevalent in Yemen. As you can see here, there are two groups fighting. Okay, very good. Siva Jani and Mukram Hussein, you have answered this correctly. So Houthis are fighting against the Saudis in Yemen. So there is a proxy war that is played out between Iran and Saudi Arabia in Yemen. So Yemen is having a civil war. In Lebanon, we don't have any civil war. Yemen used to have a civil war between 1975 and 1989-90. But we don't have a civil war at present. But there is a serious political crisis. So people are protesting against corruption as well as the economic problems that are faced by them. So there is a serious political crisis, but there is no civil war going on. Yes, in Libya, we have a civil war. In fact, we have a civil war between various tribal militias in Libya. And in Chile, we don't have any civil war. Last year in 2019, there have been serious protests against the government. So anti-government protests prevailed in Chile. So but as of now, there is no civil war going on in Chile. So the answer for this question is A and C only. So very good. So two of you have answered this correctly. So Yemen and Libya are the two countries where there is a civil war which is prevalent. So you need to follow the developments which have taken place from August 2019 to August 2020. For this year's prelims examination, because since the prelims has been postponed, I hope that they have prepared a new paper, and if they have prepared a new paper, then they may ask you questions on important developments that have taken place in the months of July and August also. So you have to go through the developments in the months of May, June, July, August. So 4 months, very very important. Let us move on to the next question. Consider the following statements. Jnanpith is the highest literary award conferred on an individual by the government of India. Second, Akkitham Achyutham Nambudiri is the latest recipient of the Jnanpith award. So let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. So I'll be waiting for some 30 seconds. What is the answer for this question? Okay, so first statement, whether this is correct or not, let us see here. So the first statement is Jnanpith Award is the highest literary award conferred on an individual by the government of India. This is a wrong statement. So this is considered to be the highest literary award, but it is not conferred by the government of India. It is conferred by an organization called Bharatiya Jnanpith. So it is not an award given by the government of India. It is an award given by an organization called Bharatiya Jnanpith. Okay. So this is an award given by a private organization. The award that is given by the government of India is Sahitya Academy Awards. Sahitya Academy Awards. Okay. Then the second statement is Akkitham Achyutham Nambudiri is the latest recipient of the Jnanpith Award. This is correct statement. So Akkitham Achyutham Nambudiri. So he is a prominent person in Malayalam literature, and this person was awarded the Jnanpith Award recently. So statement B is correct. But statement A is not correct. So you have to watch and observe these statements carefully before choosing the answer, because you cannot commit more than two or three silly mistakes in the examination. So every mark is valuable. So every question is important. So you should not commit more than one or two silly mistakes. Okay. Let us move on to the next topic. So next question, which of the following criteria has the lowest weightage assigned by the Finance Commission in determining the horizontal distribution between states? As you all know, the 15th Finance Commission, here we are talking about the 15th Finance Commission, since they have submitted a report for the financial year 2020 and 2021. So on what basis have they determined the horizontal devolution of power? On what basis have they determined the horizontal devolution of power? So I think there is some component of the question that has been cut. So I'll read the question. Which of the following criteria has the lowest weightage assigned by the Finance Commission in the determination of horizontal, in determining horizontal devolution between states? What is the answer here? So the answer here is tax effort. So tax effort is the answer. So tax effort has a weightage of 2.5%. So as you all know, the Constitution of India provides for a federal form of government, and this is reflected in Schedule 7 of the Constitution of India. So Schedule 7 divides the subjects into three groups. So there are three groups into which subjects are divided. What are those groups? So first is the union list, then we have the state list, then we have the concurrent list. These subjects also include important tax subjects. So taxation subjects are also included in these three lists. Interestingly, the Constitution of India has given most of the development related subjects to states. So the states have got most of the development related subjects. For example, health is a subject in the state list, land is a subject in the state list, sanitation is a subject in the state list. But states do not have significant financial resources. They do not have important financial subjects. The important taxation related subjects are with the union government. For example, income tax is with the union government. Similarly, corporate tax is also with the union government. So these are two important taxes. Now GST, which was earlier called VAT, or the sales tax, which was the key source of revenue for the states, has also been taken away from the states, and GST has also been added to the, I mean, GST has both the jurisdiction of the union government as well as the state government. So in order to ensure that the states receive money, there is an organization called the Finance Commission. The Finance Commission is responsible for making recommendations. These recommendations are not binding, so you have to remember this. So they make recommendations, and these recommendations are made to the union government, and these recommendations determine what percentage of the taxes should be given to the central government and what percentage should be given to the state governments. So recently the 15th Finance Commission has said that the central government should have 59% of the total taxes that are collected, and state should have 41% of the taxes. So all states together will get 41%. Assume that the central government has collected taxes worth 100 crores, and out of these 100 crores, 59 crores are given to the central government and 41 crores are given to the state governments. Okay, and who should get what in this 41 crores? So how should these be divided among the 28 states and 8 union territories? So no, it is not, the union territories will have it their share in the central pool, but how do we divide the 41% among the 28 states? For this, the Finance Commission has a formula. What is the formula that is opted by the Finance Commission? So we are talking about the 15th Finance Commission. So 15th Finance Commission has used 6 parameters to determine the share of each state. What is the share of each state according to the 15th Finance Commission? So first parameter is income distance. Income distance is the most important parameter, and it has a weightage of 45%. Income distance is the gap between the state's per capita income with the highest per capita income state. So the gap that exists between the state's per capita income with the state which has the highest per capita income is called income distance. So using this criteria, so poor states get more money and rich states get less money. So Kerala is said to be one of the states where the per capita income is high. So Kerala will receive less money under this particular criteria. What else are the other parameters? So population is one parameter, area is another parameter, demographic performance is another parameter, tax effort. This is very, very important for this year's prelims exam. Tax effort and forest. Okay, so population has 15% weightage, but this population is 2011 census. It is not according to the 1971 census. It is according to the 2011 census. Area is having a weightage of 15%. So the greater the area of a state, the more the amount that a particular state receives. Then we have demographic performance. Demographic performance has a weightage of 12.5%. Then tax effort. Tax effort will have a weightage of 2.5%. And forest will have a weightage of 10%. So you have to remember the parameters as well as the weightage for each parameter. So the most important criteria that is used by the Finance Commission to determine the share of a state is income distance. Poor states get more money than the rich states because they have a big gap between themselves and with the state which has the highest per capita income. After income distance, then we have other parameters like population according to the 2011 census. Then we have area, 15%. Demographic performance 12.5%, tax effort 2.5%, forest 10%. Okay, this is very important. So this question is, which of the following has the lowest weightage assigned by the 15th Finance Commission in the determining horizontal devolution between states? So the answer is tax effort. Let us see the next question. Consider the following statements. So there is no such thing as national disaster tag given in India to natural disasters. Second, natural disasters are classified as L1, L2 and L3. So let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. So what is the answer for this question? So what is the answer? So Mukarram Hussain says it is 3. So the answer for this question is both A and B. So both are correct. So whenever there is a natural disaster that occurs in our country, for example, recently there has been a cyclone which has devastated the state of West Bengal. So it has affected the state of West Bengal. So after the cyclone, the government of West Bengal has demanded the central government to declare this as a national disaster. National disaster. But the central government has said that there is no such thing as a national disaster and they cannot declare any disaster as a national disaster. So they have not declared it as a national disaster because there is no such thing as a national disaster under any law enacted by the parliament. The natural disasters of our country are classified into L1, L2, L3. This is very, very important. We don't have any national disasters. The highest classification that is given to a disaster is L3 disaster. What do you mean by L1, L2, L3 and where are they mentioned? So this classification of natural disasters is mentioned in the National Disaster Management Plan, which was unveiled by the Government of India in 2016. So they have released a plan called National Disaster Management Plan, and according to this plan, natural disasters are classified into L1, L2, L3. L3. Okay. Okay, then what is L1 disaster? And what is L2 and what is L3? So L1 is a disaster which can be managed by the authorities at the district level. So if the disaster can be managed by the authorities at the district level, then it is classified as an L1 disaster. If the district authorities do not have the resources to manage a particular disaster and if they require the help of the state governments, then that disaster is classified as L2 disasters. So this require the assistance given to the district level authorities by the state government. And if the state government itself is not in a position to handle a particular disaster which is of a greater scale, then they require the assistance of the central government. And in such a situation, we call that disaster as an L3 disaster. So disasters are classified into three categories, L1, L2, L3 under the National Disaster Management Plan of 2016. So you have to remember that there is no such thing called a national disaster. Natural disasters are classified into three categories, L1, L2 and L3. So small disasters which have a local impact are classified as L1 disasters. So a disaster which affects the entire state is classified as L2 disaster. And if it is far more serious, then it is called an L3 disaster. So this is something which you need to know. So let us move on to the next question. Consider the following statements on Purchasing Managers Index. So what do you mean by Purchasing Managers Index? What do you know about the Purchasing Managers Index? So these are the two statements here. What is meant by Purchasing Managers Index? Okay. Okay, so what is the answer for this question? So consider the following statements on purchasing managers index, so PMI. So if there is any component of the question that is in cut by my image, so it is PMI, purchasing managers index. So what is the answer here? So first let us see what is the statement. So statement one, is this correct or not? Yes, first statement is correct. So purchasing manager index is considered as an indicator of the economic health and investor sentiments about the manufacturing sector. In the purchasing managers index data, a reading above 50 indicates economic expansion, while a reading below 50 points to contraction of economic activities. Both these statements are correct. So you must know that the performance of the manufacturing sector in India, so the performance of the manufacturing sector in India is measured using two indexes. One is called the IIP, which is released by the government of India, and the other index that is used to measure the performance of the manufacturing sector is purchasing managers index. Purchasing managers index in fact measures performance of both manufacturing as well as services. So there are two PMIs, one is PMI for manufacturing and the other is PMI for services. The organization that releases the purchasing managers index is IHS Markit. So IHS Markit is the organization which releases the purchasing managers index. This is something which is important, you need to know. And in the purchasing managers index, a value of more than 50, so if the value is more than 50, then it means that the economy or the manufacturing is expanding. So economy and the manufacturing sector is expanding. So the value more than 50 indicates that it is expanding. And if the value is less than 50, then it means that it is contracting. It means that it is contracting. So it is released usually on the first of every month. So it is released on the first of every month. You have to remember this point. And it is released by a private organization, that is IHS Markit. So IHS Markit is the organization which releases the purchasing managers index. So this is something which you need to know. So let us move on to the next question. So S-400 missile defense system, S-400 Triumph missile defense system will be delivered to India by which of the following nations? So which nation delivers the S-400 Triumph missile defense system to India? This is a straightforward question, but a very, very important question for this year's prelims examination. So S-400 missile defense system will be delivered to India by which of the following nations? So what is the answer for this question? So the answer for this question, this is a straightforward question. The answer for this question is Russia. So the S-400 missile defense system is considered to be, S-400 Triumph missile defense system is considered to be the most advanced missile defense system in the world. It helps a country from incoming missile attacks. So it helps a particular nation which has deployed this defense system from incoming missile attacks. So there are a number of countries which have placed orders for the S-400 Triumph missile system. For example, Turkey is one country which has placed orders. India has also placed an order for the S-400 Triumph missile defense system. This was in the news because there is an act which was enacted by the US that is called CATSA, that is Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. And CATSA threatens countries with sanctions if they do any transaction or if they are involved in doing any significant transaction, that is the word which has been used. So significant transactions with countries like Russia, Iran and North Korea. So if countries are involved in any transaction with Russia, Iran or North Korea, then these countries will impose sanctions. So this is something which you need to know. Yes, sanctions involve the countries cannot do business with America. American companies are prohibited from doing business with companies which do transactions with this. So, for example, CARTSA imposes sanctions on countries which have dealt with Russia. So, Indian Defense Ministry is buying the Russian equipment, which means Indian Defense Ministry will be sanctioned. So, USA will not be selling any cutting-edge defense technologies to India. So, that is what is worrying India. We are strengthening our cooperation, defense cooperation with the United States of America, but that has at the same time, we have not reduced our dependence on Russia. So, we are trying to balance our defense relationship between Russia and the United States of America, and this has become a major headache. That is, CARTSA has become a major headache for India. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Consider the following statements on being declared as Maharatnas. What criteria should be fulfilled if a company has to be declared as a Maharatna? So what is the answer here? The answer for this question is both A and B are correct. So in order to be declared as a Maharatna, a company should have a turnover of 25,000 crores. So this should be the turnover. And it should have generated a profit of 5,000 crores, at least 5,000 crores. And it should be having a net worth. Net worth means assets minus liabilities. So it should have a net worth of at least 15,000 crores. If a company fulfills these three criteria, it can be declared as a Maharatna. So it should have a turnover of 25,000 crores, it should have a profit of 5,000 crores, and its net worth should be at least 15,000 crores. That is the gap between assets and liabilities. So as of today, we have 10 Maharatnas. So the latest companies to have been declared as Maharatnas are Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. So this is the last, and HPCL, Hindustan Petroleum Corporation Limited. So these two companies were declared as Maharatnas in 2019. So they can give you a question on the criteria to be fulfilled for a company to be declared as a Maharatna. So please go through the list of Maharatnas. There are 10 Maharatnas and there are 14 Navaratnas. So you may expect questions. So there are 14 Navaratnas and 10 Maharatnas. So please remember the list. You can expect a question on this particular topic. Okay. The number used for determining the vote of an MLA in the Rajya Sabha election is. So what is the answer for this question? How is the vote of an MLA determined in the Rajya Sabha election? So the answer for this question is number of MLAs into 100 by vacancies plus 1, and this entire number is added with 1. So this is the number which is required for a candidate to win the election. To the Rajya Sabha. So every MLA will have a vote value of 100. So, in order to get elected to the Rajya Sabha, So there is a specific formula that is used. The formula is number of MLAs into 100 by vacancies plus 1, and this number is added with 1. So please remember this formula. It can be asked in the examination because there have been a number of elections to the Rajya Sabha. So as many as 73 seats have become vacant or will become vacant in the year 2020. So this year we will have a number of vacancies. So these vacancies will be filled. And the formula that is used here in determining whether a candidates get elected to the Rajya Sabha is number of MLAs into 100 by vacancies plus 1. And this whole number is added with 1. Okay. Let us move on to the next question. This is a relatively simple question. One country, two systems, which is sometimes a constitutional principle that guides the administration of, which is sometimes in the news, sorry. Which is sometimes in the news. Is a constitutional principle that guides the administration of which of the following nations as well as autonomous regions? So the answer for this question is, this is a straightforward question, the answer is Hong Kong. So Hong Kong was a British colony, it became a British, it is now part of China, it is now administered as a special administrative region of China, and it was handed over by the British to China in the year 1997. So it remained as a British colony for 150 years. So from 1842 to 1997, Hong Kong was part of the British Empire. So in 1997, they gave back Hong Kong to China under one system called one country, two systems. This is the sacred principle under which Hong Kong was given back to China. And recently, there have been protests against China because they see that this principle is being diluted by the government of China. And that is the reason why they have protested against the Chinese government. Recently, China has enacted a security law which will be applicable to the special administrative region of Hong Kong. And people have once again hit the streets against the act on the part of the Chinese. Okay, so this is something which is important. Whenever you come across this phrase or term, one country, two systems, you must remember that this is applicable to Hong Kong. Consider the following nations: Iran, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Yemen. Which of the above are involved in the naming of cyclones? So, which of the above countries are involved in the naming of cyclones? So what is the answer for this question? The answer for this question is all the above. So this is a very important question for this year's examination. You must know first of all, how are cyclones named? So what is the procedure that is involved in the naming of cyclones? So this procedure has been changed very recently. So 13 countries are involved in the naming of cyclones. So earlier there used to be 8 countries which were involved in the naming of cyclones. So this system was adopted in 2004. But the new system was adopted in 2018 and it entered into force very recently with the naming of Cyclone Nisarga. Nisarga is the name which was given by Bangladesh under the new system. So how many countries are involved in the naming of cyclones? So there are 13 countries which are involved in the naming of cyclones. You must know the names of these countries. So first is Bangladesh. Then we have India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Maldives, Thailand, and Oman. So these 8 countries were involved in the naming of cyclones earlier, and to this 8 countries we have added 5 countries very recently, and so now a total of 13 countries will be involved in the naming of cyclones which originate in the Indian Ocean. And the every country will give a list of 13 names. So each country will give a list of 13 names. So a total of 169 names will be maintained by the Indian Meteorological Department. The Indian Meteorological Department chooses names. So the names are given by the IMD on the basis of the list. So they will take out one name after the other. So these countries are organized in an alphabetical order. So what are the 5 countries which were made part of this list of countries which are involved in the naming of cyclones? So these are the 5 countries. So Iran, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Yemen. So these are the 5 countries which have been added. So each country has given 13 names. So each country has given 13 names. You must remember the first, so there is a list of 169 names. So the first name that has been used in this list is given by Bangladesh, since Bangladesh starts first alphabetical order. This is the first country. So they have given the name called Nisarga. Can you tell me what is the country that has given the name Cyclone Amphan? So Cyclone Amphan is named by Thailand. Thailand is the country which has given the name Cyclone Amphan. So this is something which is very important. There has been a change in the procedure of naming of cyclones. You must know what is the new procedure. So very, very important for your examination. So please go through the procedure, and if possible, just go through the names that have been given by India. So what are the 13 names given by India? It can be asked. Okay, let us move on to the next question. East Turkestan Islamic Movement is active in which of the following nations? So this is a very simple question. So this movement is active in which of the following nations? Okay, so the East Turkestan Islamic Movement is a terrorist movement which is active in China. So this can be asked in this year's examination. So you must know that there is a group of people called the Uyghurs. So there are a group of people called Uyghurs, and these people are living in a province called Xinjiang. Xinjiang province of China. This is the westernmost province of China. You must have heard about Aksai Chin. Aksai Chin is being administered as part of China, Xinjiang province. Okay, so these people are a Turkic Muslim ethnic minority. So these people are Muslims, and they are closely related to the people of Central Asia. They are not that closely related to the people of the mainland China. So the mainland China is dominated by a group of people called the Han Chinese. Their culture is significantly different from the culture of the Han Chinese. And these people, that is Uyghurs, have been subjected to a number of human rights violations. So the government of China has committed a number of atrocities against the Uyghurs, and this has attracted the attention of several nations in the world, including the United States of America. And they have passed a law imposing sanctions on officials who are responsible for the oppression of what is called the Uyghurs. Okay. So something which is very, very important. So you must know that the East Turkestan Islamic Movement is a movement which has been launched by some Uyghurs. So some of them have taken up arms, and they want to have a separate nation for themselves. And this movement has been designated as a terrorist organization by the United States of America. So this is something which is important. You can expect a question here. So these group of people called the Uyghurs are often in the news. So they have launched a movement called the East Turkestan Islamic Movement, and this is active in China. So let us see this question. So the 104th Constitutional Amendment Act extends the benefit of reservation to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in the Lok Sabha and the State Legislative Assembly for 10 more years till January 25, 2030. The next statement is, this 104th Constitutional Amendment Act extends the benefit of special representation to the Anglo-Indian community in the Lok Sabha and State Legislative Assemblies for 10 more years till January 25, 2030. So what is the answer here? So what is the answer? So the answer for this question is A only. So this is something which is important. It is very rare that we come across a Constitutional Amendment Act. So Constitutional Amendment Act that was enacted recently is the 104th Constitutional Amendment Act. It was introduced as part of the 126th Constitutional Amendment Bill. So we have representation for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in the Lok Sabha under Article 330 of the Constitution, and in under Article 332 we have Anglo-Indian community that is represented in the Lok Sabha and the State Legislative Assemblies, and under Article 331 the Anglo-Indian community is provided representation in the Lok Sabha. And under Article 333, we have the Anglo-Indian community represented in the State Legislative Assembly. So there is one member of the Anglo-Indian community nominated by the governor to the State Legislative Assemblies. So this facility was initially given only for 10 years. So this benefit of reservation for both SC as well as ST and the Anglo-Indian community was given initially for 10 years, but they have extended it several times. So the first time that they have extended is through the 8th Constitutional Amendment Act. Then they have extended it to by the 23rd, then 45. So they have extended several times, I think 79, 63 and 95. Very recently they have enacted the 104th Constitutional Amendment Act. Interestingly, so they have extended the benefit of reservation only to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. They have discontinued the special representation which is available to the Anglo-Indian community. This is something which is very, very important. So they have not extended the benefit of nomination of Anglo-Indian community members to the Lok Sabha as well as the State Legislative Assemblies, but they have extended the benefit of reservation for SC as well as ST for 10 more years. So from the next Lok Sabha, we will not have any nomination of members of the Anglo-Indian community. So there are two members belonging to the Anglo-Indian community in the Lok Sabha. So the strength of the Lok Sabha will be 543 and not 545. So that is, the next Lok Sabha will have a strength of 543. This is something which you need to remember. Okay, so this is very important. So let us move on to the next topic, next question. India signed the United Nations Convention Against Torture in 1997. So India neither signed nor ratified the Arms Trade Treaty. So which is correct? So the answer here is, for example, this statement is correct and this is also correct. So India has been a signatory of the United Nations Convention Against Torture. This is a very famous convention which aims at banning or prohibition of torture, banning of torture. So this convention was in the news because recently two people, so a father and son, were killed in police custody in Tamil Nadu, and this has brought this issue into focus. So we should have ratified. So India has signed the United Nations Convention Against Torture, but we have not ratified. Ratification means enacting a law which makes that convention applicable domestically. So it makes the convention binding on India. So though we have signed the United Nations Convention Against Torture in 1997, we have not followed up the act on the part of the government of India by enacting a legislation which specifically bans torture. So this is something which you need to know. So India signed the United Nations Convention Against Torture in 1997. Yes, and India has not ratified it. Second statement is, India neither signed nor ratified the Arms Trade Treaty. This is correct. So the Arms Trade Treaty entered into force in the year 2014. The Arms Trade Treaty prohibits the trade in conventional arms. So it ensures that the conventional arms do not enter conflict zones. So conflict zones should not have access to these conventional weapons, and this is a landmark convention which was signed in 2014, but India neither signed nor ratified this particular treaty. So the answer is both A and B. So let us move on to the next question. The Permanent Court of Arbitration, which recently delivered a judgment in the Italian Marines case, is located in which country? So where is the Permanent Court of Arbitration located? So the Permanent Court of Arbitration, which recently delivered a judgment on the Italian Marines case, is located in The Hague. So The Hague is the place. So The Hague is the place which is located in Netherlands. So this is a city in Netherlands, and it also hosts several other international institutions. The ICJ, that is the International Court of Justice, the ICC, the International Criminal Court, and OPCW, the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. And we also have the Permanent Court of Arbitration. So all these international tribunals or courts are located in The Hague. So this is very, very important. So the Permanent Court of Arbitration, which recently delivered a judgment in the Italian Marines case, is based in The Hague. Let us move on to the next question. Consider the following statements. The American president is elected indirectly. So the American president is elected indirectly. Next is Donald Trump is the only president to have been impeached by the House of Representatives. What is the answer for this question? So let me answer this. So the first statement, is this correct or not? Yes, this is a correct statement. The American president is elected indirectly, and Donald Trump is the only president to have been impeached by the House of Representatives. This is wrong. So Donald Trump is the third president to have been impeached by the House of Representatives. So this is something which you need to remember. The president before Donald Trump to be impeached by the House of Representatives is Bill Clinton. However, no US president has been removed from office till date. So no US president has been removed from office till date. So this is something which is important. And many people think that the American president is elected directly. It is not correct. It is indirectly. So the American presidential election is indirect. So there will be an electoral college. People vote for members of the electoral college. There are 538 members in the electoral college. Whoever gets the support of 270 electors will be declared as the president. Okay. So the American president is not elected directly. He is elected indirectly. Correct. So Donald Trump is not the only president to have been impeached by the House of Representatives. There have been a couple of other presidents who have been impeached. So this year the election will be held. So you have to go through the American presidential elections. So it will be held on the Tuesday following the first Monday. So American presidential election is held on a specific date. So it will be held on a Tuesday following the first Monday. Okay, so this is something which is important. Then again, you must know that the president will assume office not in November, he will assume office in January 2021. So who are contesting the election? So Donald Trump will be contesting, Donald Trump and Mike Pence will be contesting the election against Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. So these are the candidates who are contesting the election. So you please follow the US presidential election. Questions can be asked on the US presidential election. So please be careful with this. Okay, then let us see what is India's rank in the Environmental Performance Index. Okay, very good, Shiva. So the answer is 3. Yes, India's rank in the Environmental Performance Index is 168. So you must remember that Environmental Performance Index is released by Yale University, and the country which ranks first in this index is Denmark. So India ranks very poorly in this index. There are only 11 countries behind India in the Environment Performance Index. So this is something which may be asked in the examination. So please expect a question on indexes. So this is a commonly asked question in the examination. So indexes, parameters, India's rank, publishing organization, and best ranking country. So this is a very, very important topic for the examination. So you can expect at least 1 to 2 questions in the prelims examination. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Consider the following sports persons: Rohit Sharma, Vinesh Phogat, Manika Batra, and M. Thangavelu. So who among them were the latest to be awarded to the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna? Who are the latest recipients among these? Who among the above . So what is the answer for this question? The answer for this question is all the above. So very recently, the government of India has announced the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Award. So the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna is regarded as the highest achievement in the field of sports in India. It is awarded for a person who has performed exceptionally well, who has performed exceptionally well in all major international events over the past 4 years. So a person who performs well for our country in important international events over the past 4 years will be given the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Award. So this is something which is important. So recently the government of India has selected 4 persons for the prestigious Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Award. So this is something which you need to know. There can be a question in the examination. Okay. So this is the highest achievement in the field of sports in India. So it is the highest achievement in the field of sports in India. Okay. Let us move on to the next question. Sampriti is a joint military exercise held between India and So let us see how many of you can answer this. So the answer for this question is Bangladesh. So this is also a commonly asked question in competitive examinations. So you must study everything related to military exercises. You come across a number of military exercises which are conducted by India. So India has military exercises with various other countries in the world. So you must prepare this topic thoroughly. So for example, with Bangladesh, we have what is called Sampriti. At the same time, with other countries like China, we have one famous military exercise that is called Hand in Hand. And in the recent period, we have come across a prominent military exercise called Malabar. So Malabar is a naval exercise which is having 3 participants: India, Japan, and the United States of America. So there has been a lot of discussion on Malabar naval exercise because India is planning to invite Australia to join as a permanent member in this naval exercise. We will have to check whether they will join or whether India will extend the invitation to Australia or not. But India is seriously thinking about inviting Australia to join the Malabar naval exercise. So military exercises is something which is important for your exam. So please go through this topic thoroughly. So India has military exercises with many countries of the world. So please make a list of countries with which India has military exercises. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. World Economic Outlook is a report published by which of the following organizations? So World Economic Outlook is a report published by which of the following organizations? So this is also a very important topic for your examination. So reports and publishing organization. So there are a number of reports that are published every year. You must know the organizations which are involved in publishing these reports. So reports and publishing organizations are very important. So the World Economic Outlook is published by the IMF. So IMF is the organization which publishes the World Economic Outlook. So this has been asked in the past. So you can expect questions. Similarly, for example, we have UNCTAD, UNCTAD. So this organization is responsible for releasing the World Investment Report. So the World Bank releases what is called the Ease of Doing Business Report. So this is a very important topic for the exam. So please follow this thoroughly. Okay. So next question, which of the following categories has the highest weightage in the consumer price index? So in the consumer price index, which has the highest weightage? Okay, so what is the answer to this question? So the consumer price index is the index that is taken into consideration by the monetary policy committee to fix the key rates. So inflation in our country is based on the values of CPI. So this is something which is very, very important. So consumer price index is very important for the examination. So there are six categories into which the items are placed in the consumer price index. So the highest weightage is assigned for food and beverages. So this is 45.86%. So there are six categories, as I have told you. The other category is clothing, and there is one more category called miscellaneous. So these are the six categories. For example, miscellaneous category has a weightage of some 27.4%. So please check the weightage that is assigned for each and every category. But you must remember that food and beverages has the highest weightage in the consumer price index. You must know everything about the consumer price index. It is a commonly asked question in the examination. It is released by the CSO. A very commonly asked question in the exam. Okay. Consider the following nations. Consider the following nations. Mahendra Kumar, so please call me at this number if you want me to give you some information about how to prepare. So if you are interested, then you can call me at this number. Anyways, you can also watch a number of videos on Unacademy on how to prepare for this examination. Okay. So consider the following nations. So Brunei, Bahrain, Oman and Mexico. Which of the above are members of OPEC? OPEC plus. It is not OPEC. OPEC plus. So let us see how many of you can answer this question. Okay, so what is the answer for this question? The answer for this question is all the above. This is a very, very important question for this year's exam. So you might have come across oil prices. So oil prices have fluctuated significantly in the recent year. So in the recent 12 months, there have been significant fluctuations in the oil prices. And the oil prices are determined by two prominent organizations. One is OPEC and the other is OPEC Plus. OPEC is a grouping of 13 countries which was established in the year 1960. The headquarters of OPEC are located in Vienna, and Saudi Arabia acts as the de facto leader of OPEC. However, OPEC accounts for just 40% or 41% of the global oil production. There are some other important oil producing countries in the world, and these countries are together called OPEC plus countries. So these OPEC plus includes OPEC, that is 13, plus 10 other important producers of oil. So these 10 other countries include countries like Russia, Kazakhstan, as I've told you, Brunei, Bahrain, Oman, etc. So please go through the list of the 23 countries which form part of OPEC plus. So if you have not studied this, please go through this. Interestingly, you must know that the United States of America is the largest producer of crude oil in the world. It is not Saudi Arabia or Russia. It is the United States of America which produces the most crude oil in the world. But USA is neither a member of OPEC nor a member of OPEC plus. So this is something which you need to know. So it is neither a member of OPEC nor OPEC plus. Okay, let us move on to the next question. So what is the next question? Consider the following intangible cultural heritage and state. So I have given you three intangible cultural heritage practices of India, and I have also given the state. So which of these are correctly paired? So what are the correct pairing? So what is the correct pairing? Let me see how many of you can answer this correctly. So the answer for this question is all the above. So So all the above. So this you can see here, there the Ministry of Culture has recently released the national list of intangible cultural heritage. This is very, very important for the exam this year. So prominent cultural practices of our country are included in the national list of intangible cultural heritage. So the Ministry of Culture has recently released a draft of the National List of Intangible Cultural Heritage. So there are a total of 106 cultural practices included in this list. So you must study all these cultural practices. Very, very important for the examination. All these cultural practices are important for the examination. So there are 106 cultural practices. All of them are important. So here we have Jangam Gayam. So it is a form of storytelling prevalent in Haryana. Similarly, Kariala is a popular practice in Himachal Pradesh. Charbat is prominent in some other states also, but it is mostly Madhya Pradesh. So it is also prevalent in Hyderabad, Mumbai, but it is mostly in Madhya Pradesh that we hear about Charbat. Charbait or something. So this is something which is very important for the examination. So all the above. So let us move on to the next question. So what is the answer for this question? Just hold on. So what is the answer here? So the answer for this question is benchmark for oil trade. So this is very, very important. So you have two prominent benchmarks for oil trade. So they are Brent crude and Western Texas Intermediate. So this is a prominent benchmark which is prevalent in the United States of America, and this Brent crude is prevalent all over the world. So the international oil prices are determined on the basis of the prevailing Brent crude. Okay, so this is something which is very, very important. So Brent blend is a benchmark for oil trade. So let us move on to the next question. West Texas Intermediate. So escape clause, which is often seen in the news, is available under which of the following laws? So where do we come across this term called escape clause? Okay, so the answer for this question is the FRBM Act. So the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act fixes, they determine the rates of fiscal deficit which must be achieved by the government. So in case the government fails to achieve the FD targets, then they can use what is called the escape clause. So the escape clause is something which is in the news because the government of India has missed the FD targets for the financial year 2019 and 20, and they have taken recourse to the escape clause. Similarly, they will be missing the targets for the financial year 2020-21 because of COVID-19. So because of COVID-19, we have seen a significant decline in the revenue of the central government, but the expenditure has remained more or less the same. So in this situation, we will have an increase in the fiscal deficit. So this is possible under what is called the escape clause. So it is being said that the fiscal deficit will breach 5% also. So FRBM Act allows the government to breach the FD target by 0.5%. Okay. Next. Which of the following is the nodal agency for the promotion of foreign direct investment in India? So which organization is responsible for promoting FDI in India? Okay, the answer for this question is DPIIT. So, Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. If I'm not wrong, this is the abbreviation. So, this is the organization under the Ministry of Commerce, which is responsible for promoting foreign direct investment in India. Okay, Department for the Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. So this has been actively involved in the promotion of foreign direct investment in India. So according to the World Investment Report, India's rank in the FDI is 9th. So India is the 9th largest recipient of FDI in the world. So this has been revealed by an organization called UNCTAD. So United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. So you must know the rank of India in the world among the countries in FDI, in receiving FDI. So this next question is also commonly asked in the examination. So I have given a geographical indication. I have also given a state. So I have given three geographical indications and I have given three states. Which of these are correctly matched? Okay, so the answer for this question is all of them are correct. So, Kola Chili is a geographical indication from Goa. Idumishmi textiles are a geographical indication from Arunachal Pradesh. And Kaji Nemu is a geographical indication from Assam. So, all of them are correct. So, if you have not read about geographical indications, so please go through this topic. This is very, very important for your exam. So, geographical indications is a commonly asked question in the civil services prelims examination. So, expect one question, at least one question in the CSP 2020 on geographical indications. So, start reading GIE from the latest geographical indications. So, okay. Next question. Consider the following categories. Literature, newspaper and online journalism, musical composition. In which of the above categories is the Pulitzer Prize announced? Okay, so the answer for this question is all the above. So Pulitzer Prize is something which is very, very important. It is given by the Columbia University. It is named after Joseph Pulitzer. So it is given in literature. It is also given in newspaper and online journalism. And it is given in musical composition also. So the answer is all the above. All the above is correct. So please go through the categories in which Pulitzer Prize is awarded. So two photographers from Kashmir were also awarded the Pulitzer Prize this year. So this is very important. Okay. The Open Skies Treaty was negotiated between NATO and former Warsaw Pact countries in the year. In which year have the NATO countries and the former Warsaw Pact countries negotiated what is called the Open Skies Treaty? So the Open Skies Treaty is in the news because the United States of America has expressed its intention to exit the Open Skies Treaty. So in this context, we must study about the Open Skies Treaty. So what is the answer? So the answer for this question is 1992. So it was negotiated in the year 1992 and it entered into force in 2002. So it entered into force in 2002 and it was negotiated in the year 1992. Okay, so this is a very important treaty. So please go through this treaty if you have not read this till date. Okay, next. Consider the following statements on Pradhan Mantri Vaya Vandana Yojana. So what do you know about the Pradhan Mantri Vaya Vandana Yojana? It is a social security scheme for senior citizens, SC, ST and widows. LIC is solely authorized to operate this scheme, which works as a non-linked, non-participating pension scheme subsidized by the center. Okay, so what is the answer for this question? So this question forms part of a very important topic for the civil service examination, that is schemes and features. So this is the most important topic for the civil service examination. You can expect at least 5 questions in one way or the other on this topic. So please be thorough with schemes and features. It is a commonly asked question in the exam. So what is the answer for this question? So it is a social security scheme for senior citizens, SC, ST and widows. No, this is a wrong statement. It is a social security scheme only for senior citizens. SC, ST and widows are not included here. Okay, so it is a social security scheme for senior citizens and LIC is solely authorized to operate this scheme, which works as a non-linked, non-participating pension scheme subsidized by the center. This is correct. So the answer for this question is B only. So this is a social security scheme under which there will be an assured rate of interest on deposits made by senior citizens. LIC is the organization that is responsible for implementing this scheme. So this is very important. So don't come to a conclusion by reading the partial statement. You have to complete the statement. So you have to remember that this is a scheme applicable only for senior citizens and not for SC, ST and widows. Okay. Consider the following statements on super earth. So last year scientists have identified a super earth called K2-18b. So it is said that it may support life. It was discovered by the Kepler telescope in 2015. So but what do you mean by a super earth? So I have given 2 statements. A super earth is a planet with a mass between 1 and 10 times of earth. The super earth classification refers only to the mass of the planet and does not imply anything about its surface conditions or habitability. So the answer for this question is both A and B are correct. So a super earth is an exoplanet. So you must remember a super earth is an exoplanet. So an exoplanet is a planet that is outside the solar system. So a planet that is outside the solar system is called an exoplanet. Some of these exoplanets may be habitable. So we are still exploring the exoplanets. So there are millions of exoplanets. So in order to be classified as an exoplanet, the mass of that planet must be, in order to be classified as a super earth, the mass of the exoplanet must be 1 to 10 times that of earth. So this is something which is important. You must remember this. The super earth classification refers only to the mass of the planet and does not imply anything to about its surface conditions or habitability. This is also correct. It only deals with the mass of the planet. It does not specify whether a super earth is habitable or if it has surface conditions which are habitable or not. So this is both the statements are correct in this question. So this is also very important. I have given you 2 statements. So next question, I have given you 2 statements on the chief of defense staff. So which of these statements are correct? So what is the first statement? The Chief of Defence Staff will head the Department of Military Affairs to be created within the Ministry of Defence and function as its secretary. It is correct. So he will head the Department of Military Affairs. Chief of Defence Staff will not exercise any military command, including over the three service chiefs. This is also correct. So in this case, both these statements are correct. The Chief of Defence Staff has been created to provide military advice to the defense minister. So on all aspects related to the defense of our country, he acts as the sole advisor to the defense minister. He will head the Department of Military Affairs, but he will not exercise any authority over any of the three service chiefs. So he has his own role. His role is advisory in nature. So recently, last year on August 15, the Prime Minister announced the creation of the Chief of Defence Staff, and this post was created, and the first Chief of Defence Staff who was appointed was Bipin Rawat. So Bipin Rawat, who was the former Chief of the Army, became the first Chief of Defence Staff. This is very important for the election. So next, consider the following statements on electoral bonds. So I have given you two statements on electoral bonds. Which of these statements are correct? Only the registered political parties which have secured not less than 1% of the votes polled in the Lok Sabha elections or the state legislative assembly are eligible to receive electoral bonds. A firm could donate a maximum of 7.5% of its average 3-year net profit as political donations. So I'll give you some 30 seconds to go through this question. Okay, so let us see what is the answer here. So only the registered political parties which have secured not less than 1% of the votes polled in the last Lok Sabha elections or state legislative assembly elections are eligible to receive electoral bonds. So this is the correct statement. Not all political parties are eligible to get money in the form of electoral bonds. Only some parties, that too those parties which have received 1% vote share. So they must have received 1% vote share compulsorily, and only those are eligible. So if you have not read about electoral bonds, this is a very, very important topic. It has become very controversial also. So you study this topic not just for the prelims examination but also for the mains examination. This is important. Then what is the second statement? So the second statement is a firm could donate a maximum of 7.5% of its average 3-year net profit as political donation. This is wrong, because earlier they can donate only up to 7.5% of their profit, but now they can donate any amount. So there is no restriction on the amount that can be given as donation to a political party. So they can donate any amount of money to a political party. So this is something which is important. So the second statement is wrong, but the first statement is correct. So the answer is A only. Okay. So let us move on to the next question. So this is also something which is in the news. Locust attack. So there has been a locust attack which affected the agriculture in as many as 5 states of India. So what do you understand by a locust or desert locust? Okay, so let us see what the answer is. Desert locusts can be considered to be natives of Saudi Arabia or the Arabian Peninsula. This is correct. So they are native, or they are originally from Saudi Arabia or the Arabian Peninsula. So desert locusts are grasshopper like creatures, and they cause a lot of destruction to the agriculture. So they move rapidly in large numbers in search of moisture, and in the process they also destroy fields. So, following monsoon winds, they arrive in Rajasthan and Gujarat every year. So, is this correct? So, following the monsoon winds, they arrive in India, in Rajasthan and Gujarat particularly every year. So, this is also correct. So, both these statements are correct. So, you must know that both these statements are correct. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Which of the following schemes was suspended by the central government for 2 years? Which scheme was suspended by the central government for 2 years? So this has become a controversial decision on the part of the central government. So this is a simple question. So what is the answer here? So the answer for this question is MPLADS. So Member of Parliament Local Area Development Scheme. So this is a scheme which was launched in 1993. Under this scheme, every MP is given 5 crore rupees for carrying out development works in his constituency, in his Lok Sabha constituency. A Rajya Sabha MP can carry or recommend works in the state from which he got elected. So this scheme was suspended by the central government very recently. So they have said that they will be suspending this scheme for as many as 2 years. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Ali Musaliar and Varian Kunnak Kunhamed Haji were prominent leaders of which of the following movements? Which of these movements were led by Ali Musaliar and Varian Kunnak Kunhamed Haji? So this is also a very important topic. I am expecting a question on this issue this year. So this answer is Mopla Rebellion. So this Mopla Rebellion will be observing 100 years. So it was started in 1921 and 2021 marks the 100th anniversary of this rebellion. So a number of films have been announced on the Mopla Rebellion. So in this context, you have come across this person, Haji, and there are a number of films who are portraying this person. So this picture has also become very controversial. So you must know this Mopla Rebellion. So this can also be asked for this year's mains examination. So please go through this rebellion. Very important. Next question. Consider the following presidents: V.V. Giri, S. Radhakrishna, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Neelam Sanjeev Reddy. Who among the above were conferred the Bharat Ratna? So who among these people were awarded the Bharat Ratna? So what is the answer here? So did V.V. Giri get the Bharat Ratna? Yes, he got the Bharat Ratna. Second, did S.R. Radhakrishnan get the Bharat Ratna? Yes, he also got the Bharat Ratna. Rajendra Prasad? Yes, he also got the Bharat Ratna. Neelam Sanjeev Reddy? No, he did not get the Bharat Ratna. So the answer for this question is ABC only. So this is important because Pranab Mukherjee got the Bharat Ratna in 2019. So in 2019, Bharat Ratna was given to Nanaji Deshmukh, Pranab Mukherjee and Bhupen Hazarika. So you can expect a question in this year's prelims examination on the Bharat Ratna. Bharat Ratna is the highest civilian award given by the government of India. So it is given by the President of India on the recommendation of the Prime Minister. Okay. So this is something which is important. There is one more president who got the Bharat Ratna. So Zakir Hussain. So Zakir Hussain got the Bharat Ratna and Pranab Mukherjee got the Bharat Ratna. I think a total of 5 presidents got the Bharat Ratna. So please remember the names of the 5 presidents who got the Bharat Ratna. Very important for this year's exam. Okay. Next, Maastricht Treaty resulted in the creation of the European Union. The city of Maastricht is located in Maastricht or Maastricht. So in which country is this city located? So you can expect these questions in the examination. So European Union is in the news because of Brexit. Finally, Brexit has happened. So UK has left the European Union on I think 31st January 2020. So after several years. So in 2016 a referendum was held. They were supposed to leave in 2019 in the month of March, but this was extended two times and they finally left on 31st January 2020. So where is this particular city located? So it is located in Netherlands. So the European Union was formally formed, if I am not wrong, in 1993 after the Maastricht Treaty. Okay, so this is something which is important, can be asked in the examination. The National Tiger Conservation Authority was given statutory status by which of the following laws? So which law has given statutory status to the National Tiger Conservation Authority? So the answer for this question, such questions can be asked in the examination. So the National Tiger Conservation Authority was initially established in 2005 and it was conferred statutory status in 2006 under the Wildlife Protection Act. So there was an amendment which was carried out to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 in 2006, and this amendment gave NTCA statutory authority. And you must remember that this is responsible, this is the organization that is responsible for tiger conservation in India. So there are as many as 50 tiger reserves in our country. You must study or go through all the 50 tiger reserves in our country. Very, very important. Apart from this, you must also know what is a tiger reserve. So a tiger reserve can be either a national park or a wildlife sanctuary, which is very important for the conservation of tiger. It is having two areas, one is called the core area and the other is called the buffer area. So please go through the list of 50 tiger reserves in our country. So recently the status of tiger report was released by the government of India. According to that report, there are some 2900 plus tigers in our country. And which state has the highest number of tigers? The state which has the highest number of tigers is Madhya Pradesh, followed by Karnataka. And the tiger reserve which has the highest number of tigers and the highest density of tigers is Jim Corbett Tiger Reserve. Okay, so this is in Uttarakhand. Okay, so can you tell me what is the answer for this question? So in which of the following nations are there two governments, namely Government of National Accord and the Tobruk Administration? In which country do we have two administrations? So there is a civil war prevalent in this country. So which country has two administrations? One is controlling the western part of that country and the other administration is controlling the eastern part of the country. So the answer for this question is Libya. So Libya is the country which has two administrations. So Libya has been going through a civil war for several years. So since the death of Muammar Gaddafi, this place has seen chaos. So it has been a chaotic situation in Libya since 2011-12. So there are a number of militias that are fighting against each other. They either support the government of National Accord or the Tobruk administration or the Libyan National Army. So countries of the world are also divided. The government of National Accord is the government recognized by the United Nations. But there are countries which support the Tobruk administration also. This is something which is important, can be asked in the examination. So there has been a lot of violence in Libya. So you can expect a question on Libya this year. Consider the following cities: Jaipur, Varanasi, Hyderabad, Chennai. Which of the above cities are recognized as UNESCO creative cities? So in which of these cities are recognized as creative cities by the UNESCO? What is the answer here? So, is Jaipur a UNESCO creative city? Yes. Is Varanasi a UNESCO creative city? Yes. Hyderabad? Yes. Chennai? Yes. There is one more creative city of India. So, that city is Mumbai. Mumbai has been recognized as a creative city in the field of films. Hyderabad enjoys the status as a creative city in the field of gastronomy. So there are seven areas, seven fields from which creative cities are recognized. So the answer is for all of them. So very, very important for your examination. So UNESCO Creative Cities Network. So if you have not read about the UNESCO Creative Cities Network, so please go through it. Okay, so which of the following nations witnessed a military coup recently? Very recently, there has been a change in the government forced by the military. So in which country have you come across a military coup? Very recently, a couple of days ago, this incident has happened. Okay, so the answer for this question is Mali. So Mali is the country, the capital of Mali is Bamako, and this is the country which has seen a military coup, an unfortunate event. This is a country in Africa. Okay, so consider the following sectors. In which of the above sectors is FDI prohibited in India? So in which of these sectors is foreign direct investment not allowed? So FDI is very, very important for your examination. So if you have not read about FDI, so please go through this in detail. So you have to study this topic in detail. You can expect questions not just in the prelims but also the mains examination. There can be questions on foreign direct investment even in the general essay. So lottery business, gambling and betting, chit funds, Nidhi company. So the answer is all the above. So in all these sectors, foreign direct investment is not allowed in India. Okay, very, very important. So next is Boko Haram is a terrorist organization active in which of the following nations? So where do we come across this terrorist organization called Boko Haram? So Boko Haram is a terrorist organization that is very active in Nigeria. So this is one of the most dreaded terrorist organizations in the world. They have committed a number of atrocities in Nigeria. So in 2014, they have abducted school-going children, school girls, and they have married them off. So they have attained a lot of notoriety. So recently, they were responsible for killing as many as 60 people in neighboring Cameroon. So in neighboring Cameroon, they have carried out an attack, and this has brought this organization again into focus. So Nigeria is the country where we have this organization which is active. Though the Nigerian army got back the area from Boko Haram, it is still a potent force. So Boko Haram, there are two prominent terrorist organizations in Africa. One is Boko Haram, which is active in Nigeria, and there is one more organization which is called Al-Shabaab, and this terrorist organization is active in Somalia. So please remember, if you have not read this, so you also have to study the list of terrorist organizations in the world. So there are a number of terrorist organizations in the world. You must study about these terrorist organizations. You can be asked a simple question like Jaish-e-Mohammed, Lashkar-e-Taiba, Hizbul Mujahideen, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, etc. So you may be asked a question on where a particular organization is active. So this is very important for your exam. So next question. Consider the following conventions or treaties. Rome Statute, United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, CTBT. Refugee Convention. So I think I have made a mistake here. So consider which of the following were neither signed nor ratified. So which of these conventions were neither signed nor ratified by India? So Rome Statute resulted in the establishment of the International Criminal Court. India is not a signatory of the Rome Statute, so we don't accept the authority of the ICC. United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, yes, we have signed the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. CTBT, no, we have not signed the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. And the 1951 Refugee Convention was also not signed by India. So the answer is B only, this is not A, this is B only, I am sorry. So the answer is only B. So Rome Statute, no. Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, no. 1951 Refugee Convention, no. But United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, yes. Okay. So let us move on to the next topic. So what is the answer for this? So Conference of Parties is a meeting that is held by the signatories of a particular convention. So I have given four conventions and I have also given the Conference of Parties of this convention. COP 14 to the United Nations Convention on Desertification was held in New Delhi. It was not held in Geneva, it was held in New Delhi. COP 13 to the CMS was held in Gandhinagar, so this is correct. COP 18 to CITES was held in Geneva, it was not held in Bonn. And COP 25 to the United Nations Framework Convention was held in Madrid. So the answer for this is B and D only. So B and D is the correct answer. So you must know the outcomes of these important events. And if you have not read about environmental treaties, so please go through environmental treaties. So it is a very important topic for your exam. Okay. So let us move on to the last question of this exam. So in an advisory opinion on the sovereignty of Chagos Islands published in February 2019, the International Court of Justice found the separation of islands in 1965 was in contravention of international law. The court urged which of the following nations to end its administration of the Chagos Islands as rapidly as possible. So what is the answer here? So which country, according to the ICJ, has illegally occupied Chagos Islands? So Chagos Islands were separated in 1965 from Mauritius Islands, and Mauritius was given independence in 1968. So before giving independence to Mauritius, they have separated Chagos Islands from Mauritius and they gave independence to Mauritius, but they have held, they got back or they have held back Chagos Islands. So the country that is now administering the Chagos Islands is United Kingdom. So UK is the country which has control over Chagos Islands. One of the island within the Chagos Islands group is Diego Garcia, and this is the place where the US has a military base. So one of the largest military bases of the United States of America is located in Diego Garcia, which was given on lease to the United States of America by the United Kingdom. Okay. So recently the ICJ has expressed its advisory opinion on the case that has been brought before it. So they have asked UK to end its administration as rapidly as possible in the Chagos Island. So this is the test. I hope you have liked it. So if you have liked it, so please comment, subscribe and share. So please use my code RRUPSC. So you please follow me on the Unacademy learning app. So there are a number of videos that I have made on the Unacademy learning app. So they are related to international relations, polity and current affairs. So thank you for listening. Thank you for participating and have a good day. Okay.